Sairam class, welcome to all. As we had completed the half portion of our chapter data handling, in which we had covered mean, mode and median. Now today we will gonna learn about bar graph, double bar graph and probability. Bar graph was also in your 6th standard. As we know that we can visually represent our data or information in pictograph or bar graph. In pictograph, we use pictures, and in bar graph, we use bars to represent data. The length of the bar in bar graph is depend upon the frequency or scale we have chosen. Now let's see an example of bar graph. In this bar graph, you can easily see that how information is visually represented with the help of bars. You can see these are called bars. And the very important thing in a graph is scale. Our scale should be appropriate so that we can represent our information properly. Now let's see what is a scale and how it is important for a graph. Now you can see here I have chosen a scale for y-axis that 1 unit is equals to 10 children. That means on y-axis 1 unit. 1 unit means a box. You can see this. 1 unit means 10 children. You can see here a small mark, a zigzag mark. This is known as kink. K-I-N-K, kink. Now, what is the use of kink in a bar graph or any graph? Now, you can see here, I have taken directly 80 after 0. And after that, my every next number is with difference of 10 number. Means the difference in other boxes is uniform. But in first box, it is directly of 80 number. So kink is used in that situation where we have to take direct a long or large step initially so that we can represent our data properly. Now you can see here I have to show all the bar graphs having frequency or data above 80. That is why I have taken 80 as first number by taking a large jump of 80 numbers, and to show that jump I have used this sign which is known as kink, so that we can say that kink use near origin. Now you can see what is origin. Origin is that point where every axis started. Or double bar graph and how it is useful. And why we use double bar graph instead of bar graph. So here you can see an example that you have given the average hours of Shun sign in two cities The first is the Margates and the second is Aberdeen. Now you can see these both cities have very less hours of sunshine as they both are near South Pole, so they have very few hours of sunshine each day. Now, if you represented them in individual bar graph, so you can easily answer questions like, in which month does each city has maximum sunlight, or in which month they have minimum sunlight. But what about such question in which you have to compare in between them? For example, in a particular month, which city has more sunshine hours? So you can see here you have to compare in between both the cities. For such situation, we have double bar graph. In a double bar graph, you just have to represent the data or information for both the cities in a single graph, in which you use two bars for a single month information. Here you can see for January, we use two graphs, the white one for Margate and the gray one for Aberdeen. And on y-axis, we have hours. So we can easily now compare that in which particular month which city has more sunshine hours. So if they are asking for the month June, so we can see that in June, Margate have large hours or more hours of sunshine than Aberdeen. Now let's start solving our exercise and we will know more about bar graph and double bar graph. In first question, you can see that we have given a bar graph and we have to answer two questions. So the first question is, which is the most popular pet? Bar for cat is larger than other pet animals. So we can say that cat is the most popular pet. Yes, so our answer is cat is the most popular pet as owned by 10 students. What is our second question? The question is, how many students have dog as a pet? So let's see. So we can see here the bar for dog touches the line of 8. So we can say that 8 students having dog as a pet. So our answer is 8 students have dog as a pet. So this one is very easy. So let's try the next one. So our question is, we have to read bar graph. Then we have to answer following questions. So let's see what we have given in bar graph. So we can see here we have number of books sold in various years. So the first question is about how many books were sold in 1989, 1990, 1992. Look it in that bar graph in which we draw a line with the help of scale to just know that what is the frequency for each and every year. So we can see here for 1989, The bar is about 200 number of books, but not exactly 200. But we can see that this is the line for 200 and this is for 100. And that bar is above half unit. So we can see it is more close to 200. So we can say that it is about 180. So we can see here the bar of 1990 year is near about half of unit, means near about 450. So we can say it should be about 460 or 470. So we can say that 465. So let's take it as 465 because it is near about half the unit. So about 465 books were sold in 1990. So it is all about our estimation. It is not exact because we are just estimating the data. So let's check for 1992. So you can see here that the bar for 1992 is near about half unit, but below that line, below the line of half unit. So we can estimate it about 230, 220. So let's estimate this as 220 books were sold in 1992. So you can see that we are just estimating the data. Okay. Now let's see what is our second question. Our second question is, in which year were about 475 books sold? It is about 475. So they are not asking for exact. So let's see in which year the bar touches near about 475 books. So we can see here, it is not, we want the bar in between this. So we can easily see that only 1990s bar for 225, the bar should in between this. As it is not in between 220, it is about 200, so we can reject it. But bar for 1992 is near about 225, is near about 225. So we can say that in 1990, about 475 books were sold, and in 1992 about 225 books were sold. As you can see that they are also asking question for near about, they are not asking for exact. So this question is all about our estimation for reading a graph. So let's see what is our next question. In which years were fewer than 250 books sold? Means in how many and which years fewer than means less than 250 books sold. So we can see that all the bar is above 250, but only bar for 1992 and 1989 is less than 250. You can see here also that only 1992 and 1989 bar is less than 250. So our answer is, in 1992 and 1989, fewer than 250 books sold. Let's see our next question. Can you explain how you would estimate the number of books sold in 1989? So it is 1989. So how we estimated? We know that it is less than 200 but more than half of units, that is 150, and it is more close to 200. So that is why we estimate it as 180. So let's see what should be our answer. On y-axis, the line is divided into 10 small parts of 10 books each, and the bar for 1989 is above half of the unit, that is 150, but below 200. So we estimate the number of books sold in 1989 is about 180. Okay, it is a theoretical answer. Let's move on to next question, in which we have given these six different classes and number of students in each class. And first we have to represent that data in a bar graph. So you can see here we have a bar graph in which we had represented the number of children in each class. First of all, we take a scale, that scale which is more suitable for our representation. So we take one unit is equals to 10 children. As we can see, we have data, all the data in multiple of 5. So if we take one unit is equals to 10 children, so we can easily represent it in graph. But we have the number of children in every class above 80. So we do not need the frequency less than 80. That is why we take kink to represent our large jump directly to 80. Now after that, for first class, means first is our fifth class. As we know that in fifth class we have 135 students. So we draw or raise its bar to 135. You can see properly that for fifth class we have 135 students. That is why we raise its bar for 135. 130, 140, and we know that every unit have 10 equal parts. That is why we can say this dark line is 135. You can see more properly that the each box is divided among 10 parts, so the exact half line is 5. So that is why this line represents 135. Similarly, we represented or show the number of children in other classes also. For example, in 6 we have 120, so we raise its bar for 120. For 7th class we have 95 students, so we have bar graph about 95 high. Now for 8th class we have 100 students, for 9th 90, and for 10th 80. Now after this we have to answer few questions. So the first question is, which class has the maximum number of children, and also we have to tell which class has minimum number of children. So we can easily answer it by observing our bar graph, that in which class the bar is largest, that class has maximum number of children. So we can answer that fifth class has maximum number of children, whereas 10th class has minimum number of children, cause its bar graph is the smallest. Its bar is the smallest. So our answer is, fifth class has the maximum number of children, that is 135, and 10th class has the minimum number of children, that is 80. Now the next question is, find the ratio of children of class 6th to student of class 8th. So we know that we have 120 students in 6th class and 100 students in 8th class. So to find out ratio in between them, we just have to divide the strength of 6th class with strength of 8th class. So when we divide it, we get 6/5. That means their ratio is 6:5. Now our second question is, means our next question is, we have given the performance of a student in two terms for five subjects. First, we have to represent that data in a double bar graph. Yes, so this is the question for double bar graph. Now you can easily see that we have given the marks for two terms. Okay, now when we represent the marks of two terms in a single graph, so we can easily compare in between these terms. Now the very first thing is scale. After that, the one another important thing for double bar graph is, when you represent two bars, so you have to differentiate in between them also. Now you can see here, I have taken the shaded bar for first term and the blank bar for second term. Now let's see for scale. Now you can see here that we have marks starting from 65. That means the lowest marks is 65 and the highest is 95. So we do not need frequency less than 65. That is why we put kink for that jump. Now we take 1 unit is equals to 15 marks. As we can see here, sorry, it is not 15, it is 5. It is by mistake. So how can we represent 67? Now we know that here we have 65. Now after two lines we have 66, and after another two lines we have 67. So that means after four lines we get 67, because one line is equals to 0.5, so two line is equals to 1, and similarly in the same way four line equals to 2 marks. Now we can easily locate all the multiple of 5s, for example 70, 65, 95, 85, 75. Now how can we locate these numbers? So let's see them. Now to locate 72 marks. So we know that this line is for 70. And we have to locate 72. So 72 means we have to jump 2 marks. So we know that one thin line is equals to 0.5. So when we multiply it with 4, we get 2. So after 4 lines, we get 72 marks. I hope you all are getting that how we can use scale and how we can represent data in graph. Now you can see for English, I represent its graph for both the terms side by side, so we can compare them easily. Similarly, for other subjects also, we represent the marks for both the terms side by. The first is in which subject has the child improved his performance the most. Means, in which subject its performance or his or her marks take a wide gap. So we can see that its bar and its bar have little difference. But we can see that for Hindi and Maths, we have large difference in bar for both the terms. Now we have to compare that how many marks difference they have. So we can see in Hindi, they have the difference for 7 marks, and in Maths, they have difference for 7 marks. But in Hindi, the difference is for decline. Means in Hindi, the performance is not improving. It's becoming poor. As having large marks in first term and less marks in second term. So our answer for first question is Maths. That in Maths, the child improves his performance the most. Now the second question is, in which subject is the improvement is least? So we have to answer for improvement. So we can see that improvement is obviously when bar will go in that way. So we know that for Maths it is most. So it will be not our answer. Also, the difference in between both bar for science is also large. But for social studies and English, compare their marks by just see the frequency in given table. So we can see that the difference in English is for 3 marks and for social studies it is for 2 marks. So we can say that in social studies the improvement is least. Now we have to answer that has the performance gone down in any subject? So we have answer Hindi. So they are our answer. You can see the first is in Maths the child is improved most. The second answer is in social studies the improvement is least. And the third is yes, in Hindi the performance gone down. Fifth question will be your homework. It is very easy. You just have to represent the data in double bar graph and answer the questions. Now, in sixth question, you have to take the temperature given for various cities in table 3.1. First, you have to plot double bar graph. So we have maximum and minimum both temperature for each and every city. So with the help of this, we can draw a bar graph for maximum and minimum temperature of cities. Now you can see we have temperature varies from 21 to 41. So if we take 1 unit equals to 10 degrees Celsius, then it will be easy for us to represent data. So we can take 1 degree Celsius for every 1/10 part of each unit. Means one thin line is equals to 1 degree Celsius.
and we differentiate the marks for maximum and minimum temperature by shading maximum temperature bar. So this data is very easy to represent. So after representing this data, we have to answer few questions, that which city has the largest difference in the minimum and maximum temperature. That means which city has large difference in between its both the bars. So we can easily see that Jammu has the large difference in between its maximum and minimum temperature. So you can see that this is for Jammu and it shows the largest difference in between its both bars. Now we have to answer that which is the hottest city and which is the coolest city. So hottest city is that in which graph, in which bars are higher, and the coolest is in which bars are lowest. So we can see bar for Jammu is highest and bars for Bangalore is lowest. So our answer is Bangalore is coolest city and Jammu is hottest city. Now the question is, name two cities where maximum temperature of one was less than the minimum temperature of the other. So we can say that Bangalore's maximum temperature is less than Ahmedabad or Jaipur's minimum temperature. As you can also see here that minimum temperature for Jaipur and Ahmedabad is 29, whereas the maximum temperature for Bangalore is 28, which is less than the minimum temperature of Jaipur and Ahmedabad. Here, 28 maximum temperature of Bangalore, whereas the minimum temperature of Ahmedabad and Jaipur is 29. Next question is, name the city which has the least difference in between its minimum and maximum temperature. So we can see in graph that the minimum difference in both the bars of Mumbai is least. So our answer is Mumbai is that city in which difference between minimum and minimum and maximum temperature is least. Now the next portion of our today's class is probability. Now what is probability? It is the extent to which an event is likely to occur. Means it is a chance for an event to occur. And how we can measure that chance? We can measure it by the ratio of the favorable cases. Favorable cases means favorable times which favors to that event to be occur. For example, I have 3 balls, 2 are red and 1 is black. So the probability of taking a red ball from all of them is, means the favorable case will be 2, because I have 2 red balls. And we have to find out the ratio of the favorable cases to the whole number of cases. Now whole number of cases are, as I have 3 balls, so the whole number of cases will be 3. So the probability will be 2 by 3. You will get to know more clearly about probability when we solve the questions related to probability. Now there are few important things related to probability. Is probability always ranges from 0 to 1. Means whenever we have probability for any event, that should be from 0 to 1, not less than 0, not more than 1. And 0 for that event which cannot be occur. And 1 is for that event which is definitely to be occur. And the rest of middle fraction probabilities is for such situations or such events which are likely to be occur but not certain. So keep in mind that zero probability for those events which cannot be occur and one for those events which are definitely to be occur. So let's see our question of exercise and you will get to know more clear about probability. Now we have first question that we have to tell whether the following events are certainly to happen. That means certainly to happen means they are definitely will be occur. So probability will be 1 for them. Or it is impossible means probability will be 0. Or can happen but not certain. So let's see what are these events. The first one is you are older today than yesterday. So we all know that we are one day older than our past day. So it is certainly to happen. Means its probability is 1. The second is a tossed coin will land heads up. So we know that a coin have two faces. Our answer is can happen but not certain. Now the next question is a die when tossed shall land up with 8 on top. Now we all know that our dice have only numbers from 1 to 6. So it could not be possible to have 8 on its top. So it is impossible to occur. So the probability for it is 0. Now the next is the next traffic light seen will be green. Now it is not up to us to decide that next traffic light will be green or red or yellow. So this event can be happen but not certain. Now the next one is tomorrow will be a cloudy day. Now this is also not in our hand. Tomorrow could be a sunny day, could be cloudy day, could be rainy. So its answer is can happen but not certain. These are the answer for all the parts you can see. Now the second question is there are 6 marbles in a box number from 1 to 6 and we have to answer that what is the probability of drawing marble with number 2. Now we know that we have 6 marbles, one ball have number 2. So the favorable case will be 1 and total number of events is 6 because we have 6 balls. So you can see here total number of marbles we have 6. So number of samples will be 6. Now number of marbles marked 2 is only 1. So number of event means favorable case is only 1. So the probability will be ratio of favorable case with total number of chances means events. So our answer is 1 by 6. So the probability is 1 by 6. Now the next part is what is the probability of drawing marble with number 5. Now also we know that we have only one marble marked number 5. So the favorable case is only 1 and number of total events is 6. So the probability will be 1 by 6 again. Now see next question. A coin is flipped to decide which team starts the game. What is the probability that your team will start? Now we know that if there are two teams, so one will take head and one will take tail. So we know that coin has two faces. That means total number of samples are two. Now number of successful event means for a particular team only one event is for their success, means whether it is tail, whether it is head. So the number of event is one. So the probability will be 1 by 2. Thank you for today.